My name is Cynthia Cicero, and I want to welcome you to this first session of our gentrification and its impact on Nevada history, the power of women working together. Today's session is going to talk about the past, women in the past, and how they kind of set the foundation, how they worked within gender roles, and developed and shaped Nevada history, and actually empowered themselves in the process. There are a couple of things I just credit I want to give. This is partially funded by a grant from Nevada Humanities, so I would like to thank them for their support. Also, I would like to introduce our planning committee team, and that is myself, Christina Eclipse, who's standing there back to there taking pictures, Dale Rowe, who just, we could have never gotten this off the ground without her. And of course, yes, you may applaud these two.
Thank you.
And of course, Sammy Cedars for doing the video for us. This is going to be taped, put up on the Women of Diversity Productions website, and then it will be archived. Also, I want to thank the people who volunteered to be facilitators, Barbara Bell, Annalyn Bocarillo, Melissa Clary, is Melissa here? And, okay, and Sally Rycroft.
Nancy Gasha-Brock.
I'm sorry, I took you. And also Bev Rowe, who's out there doing registration for us. Thank you, Bev, and thank you, Faye Klein, for assisting. We're going to get started. I'm going to introduce Kim Russell, who is also on our board, and I also want to introduce Clay T. White, who's also on our board, our vice president. Kim Russell is our treasurer, and I'm the secretary. Kim is also the moderator. Kim is head of education, children's education at the Smith Center. She's a playwright and Chautauqua performer, and she her most recent work actually was a play about her parents' love letters from Tuskegee that she recently performed at the Charleston Library and also in the West Side Library downtown. So we'll turn it over to Kim, and she'll tell us how this whole event is going to work, and we'll get started. Thank you.
Good morning. Let me explain something. For those of you who may not recognize it, I am of African American descent. We do have something called call and response. That means when I say good morning, you hear back. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. Thank you all for joining us for the series entitled Gentrification and Its Impact on Nevada History. It's the power of women working together. This is a three-session series created and organized and conceived by Women of Diversity with generous support from Nevada Humanities. We're grateful. Of course, today we'll be discussing the progress of women exerting and claiming power from restricted gender positions in early Nevada history. And of course, this is the first of the three. We will conclude with thoughts on how we can connect and create a more positive future for women in Nevada and beyond. This morning's session is entitled From Margins to Mainstream, How Women Established and Sustained Community While Strengthening Their Power as Equal Citizens and Laying the Foundation for Future Generations of Women to Grow. Yes, my name is Kim Russell. I am the moderator for this morning's session. We do have a very distinguished panel with us this morning, each of whom have impacted Nevada history, have impacted Nevada citizens who continue to be role models and professional icons. And we are here to be inspired by them. And of course, their role is to give us some ideas, followed by discussion afterwards. We will break into small groups and further listen to identify what they have said and talk about what questions we should be asking ourselves, what questions we should be asking of the panel, and what is it that we're actually leaving behind for the next generation. So let's think in terms of their conversation, and I would like for you to make it personal. What is your personal contributions, and where are you taking it? What have you learned from this morning? So allow me, please, how am I doing on volume? Can you hear me okay, or do I need to, do I need to shout? Okay, good, thank you. Our topic this morning is, of course, From Margins to Mainstream, And I guess the questions that we need to ask is, of course, we should probably personalize this. Talk about our own transition, fighting and battling with the margins and becoming mainstream. I think there are some very specific questions that you want to...
I took this. Save your notes.
She stole my notes. However, but I'm just going to ask, is there one particular question that you want the groups to talk about, that you want them to ask?
Dale, did you want to take care of? We kind of really want to know how this resonated with the audience, kind of what maybe some important points that they took away that they maybe didn't know or knew or were reinforced, changed their thoughts.
Right.
And what did you hear?
Did anything surprise you or change what you thought before?
Did you
hear one of the speakers? And I heard a really good question, and now I can't remember who asked it. Maybe it was you, Kim. What questions should we be asking ourselves as women in the present day? I think that's worth thinking about.
And are there any women that we may have left out that we might want to make sure that they are recorded? I think of one, Donna Andrus, who has done a lot in Nevada. So she's shaking her head no if we haven't left anybody out.
Oh, no.
We've left out many, many. It's almost impossible to include everyone.
I have a question I'd like to ask based on the information that was provided this morning. I was just sort of curiously thinking, it was interesting to hear that many of the women who did migrate into the area had more education than, you know, from the Midwest and things of this nature. But we were very sparsely populated, be it in the North or be it in the South. Did that help us or hurt us? I mean, as compared, because our problems were not unique to the rest of the country. But in some ways, I'm just wondering if it didn't help, but I'd like your thoughts.
Well.
Well, they might be something for
each group to
breakout groups.
Yeah, you know, so, because they had to rely on women more because of the sparse population, for one thing, and then if they were educated, and I'm sure they were quick to speak their minds, that it might have actually been a good thing. Having come from California, I remember thinking that there were more opportunities here than in neighboring California when I came here in the early 70s.
Well, why don't we all think about that, and we can now divide up into small groups.
Strangely enough, they had an opportunity to do what their sisters in other states
did.
And for example,
so perhaps you have some ideas from your table you'd like to share.
We first started with the question, what resonated. The first thing that was advised, we noted, was that the women, the first women of Nevada, that they were advanced, they were head of the nation. I noted that they were women of education. I'm sorry,
yeah.
Educated women, and families were people of substance. That was noted was Wild West had to do with the attitude, things can be done here. These were women of leisure. They were adventurous. There was opportunities here in Nevada that didn't exist in other places. In the rural communities, though, there were women mostly working on ranches, but they had a partnership with their mates. We also discussed one thing that we talked about was through 1972 to 1990, there was the sixth grade center that wasn't noted earlier. And correct me if I'm wrong, blacks were bused in 1 year and whites were bused in every other year. Am I wrong?
No.
I think it was just the, I'm not sure if you just said
well,
that, but I think it was just
blacks that. Were bused out and whites were bused in the sixth
okay.
grade center.
Yeah. And
I opened the sixth grade center, so yes.
Okay.
literally was one of the first teachers there.
Oh, wonderful.
Wow, awesome.
And the NAACP opened up housing in order for better integration. The League of Women did not support the sixth grade centers. Correct in saying that? And those are a couple of things that we had talked about. We had a question, but maybe we can ask it later. It's for Ida.
Yes.
Okay. One of our questions was the power of Black women organizations.
Oh, yes. The first African-American women's organization, which was a very prestigious organization at the time, was Gamma Phi Delta Sorority, Alpha Rho Chapter, made up of business and professional women, and involved in these groups was, you know, like the educators and women who had businesses of their own. And what they did, they created the cultural and social aspects of for their families. I remember they had something called the Ebony Fashion Show, where they raised thousands of dollars that helped to support the NAACP and other things, because when they had to hire lawyers and all of that kind of stuff for the NAACP, for the battles that they were in to break down these barriers, it cost money. So Gamma Phi Delta Sorority was a lifetime membership of the NAACP, and the Ebony Fashion Show was just an outstanding event that they had. Was owned by Ebony Magazine, and that's what they did throughout the country. They had sponsors like Gamma Phi Delta Sorority in numerous states throughout the country, and the purpose of that fashion show was to raise money for charitable purposes. And so outstanding Black models with very, very beautiful clothes, and I mean, they used to pack the house here in Las Vegas whenever they came on thousands and thousands of dollars. So they were the first ones who came. And the others, like the Greek letters, came later, like the AKAs and the Deltas and the National Coalition of 100 Black Women and all of those. Those are later things when many of these barriers had already been broken down.
Thank you.
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I'm Barbara Bell, and we solved all of our problems over at our table. One thing that resonated with one of our colleagues here is Sandra Asafifa, and she's from Costa Rica, and she probably say it better than I can, but comparing her country, she's been here for 12 years, so this is your country, but going back to her home country, her of origin, and although it's a democratic country, she was making a comparison that, of course, they have the same problems that we may have had back then, because it is very culturally Catholic and machismo country. So they have their own fights to fight, and as she goes back and forth to try to work with the folks that she knows back there and her homeland to try to uplift the women in that particular country. With all its beauty there and all its wonders, there is still much work to be done. Of course, we don't have that machismo problem here.
Sure.
We don't have the, you know, culturally, the cultural issues. We're just doing great.
Oh.
So, one thing that resonated with me was I never, the integration caused a fallout problem with West Las Vegas. That never occurred to me. And I think about our own recession that we went through in our own little neighborhood, how our Vons closed and Albertsons, and the small businesses definitely went back down, the small mom and pop restaurants. So my husband and I, we've been trying to hit those restaurants and hit those local places because we plan to stay there for a while and to try to incorporate it, as opposed to everything has moved way south and way to the extremes, and we don't want to travel 10 miles for a decent restaurant. So That was another part of it. As well as, we have our own, we were talking about, well, more women should own businesses, and we have our own women-owned business who put together these programs. So, just do a little marketing. And I hope I represented our table well.
So what is the name of the business?
Oh, Lazop Media. Lazop Media?
She's listed at the end of the program.
She got credits.
Oh, it's under the thank you.
It's in the program, yeah.
May I make one comment? That pattern was across the country after integration.
Really?
Yes.
Something I just hadn't thought about.
Hello, I'm Melissa Clary, and our table also had some great discussion. Some topics of resonance that we discussed. Let's see. Some of our members were very surprised or in agreement that we should be getting back to sort of those domestic values that Cynthia spoke about, in which women were responsible for passing on the issues of citizenship and democracy to their children. That was something that our table felt, some members at our table felt we've gotten away from, those simple values being passed on to the next generation. So that was an interesting topic. What else? We also discussed some of the older clubs, Mesquite Club and the Women's League of Voters, and how it was interesting they were working on such hard-hitting issues back in the 70s and beyond, and today we don't always see them working on such pressing issues. And also, I know it's amazing to hear how much they tackled in the historic talks that you were talking about, and I guess you could be summing up sort of many decades in one speech, but it seems like they tackled so much, and today we have to choose a couple causes to work on in our organizations, which segued into Dale bringing up all of these scattered women's organizations that exist. And maybe there needs to be a central issue that resonates with everybody that brings women together today in our community, so that we're working more towards a single issue. And we brought up water, especially in Nevada, as being an issue that we all face. So we discussed water being something that, you know, Pat Mulroy from the Water District, who's retired, she was a great example to some of us here, and she really brought that issue home for us, that water is something we need to constantly be thinking about, and it goes beyond social issues. Am I thinking of everything? Touching your head? Okay.
Okay, bringing the groups together.
So water would be that cause.
There's power in those numbers.
Exactly.
In the north and the south.
And it's north and south, for
and
once.
I would just like to say also, I live in the historic downtown Las Vegas, and I'm two streets away from Bracken in Huntridge neighborhood. So it's awesome to hear about some of these names, because I'm walking and living those streets. So I have a little bit more of an understanding of how the area developed and matters of importance. I'm sure, I mean, my front yard might have a tree that was planted by Mesquite Club. So.
If it's a cat, what do you
think? Thank you.
Or a mulberry.
Gentrification and its impact in Nevada history will continue. We have our next event, which is May 9th, Making Progress to Movements, and followed by May 30th, Standing on Their Shoulders. Right here, of course, we have Clay T, who will be one of our moderators on May 30th. And, you know, before we get too far, the videotaping and the recording of this and the events for Women University is extremely important. So please help me thank Sam Seegers for the special thanks to Cynthia. thank you to our wonderful guests, Ms. Patricia, Ms. Cynthia, Ms. Ida. Thank you, ladies. It's really important that the stories that we know be told, the stories that we recover stories, and that we protect our own stories too. Ladies, we have two other dates coming, but it's up to you to list and record your history and your story. Don't let this year go out and you haven't written your biography. My quest to everyone is, if you would please write about not just your successes, but your failures and what you learned from them. What should the next generation know? So, ladies, thank you so much. There's always one other person.
And
yes, Clayton.
And if you're not a writer, I am the director of the Oral History Research Center.
Yes.
I know. I will come to you and I will record your story. And a finished product, a couple of years down the road, is that it's edited and it's put in a bound volume.
Wonderful.
And you can put pictures in that bound volume. So just know that we're not all writers. And I'd like to thank you, Cynthia, for putting this together and for this vision and the facilitator.
Thank you.